Hi, everyone. I'm Erik Brynjolfsson, and this is the Stanford Digital Economy Lunch Seminar. Today, we're going to have Tomás Pueyo give a presentation about the end of nation states. Tomás was the creator of Uncharted Territories, a newsletter that analyzes the most pressing problems of our time, from automation to blockchain, inequality, aging, and many other topics. You may know him. He became famous worldwide after publishing a number of high-profile articles viewed by over 60 million people, in particular The Hammer and The Dance, about how to fight coronavirus. I'm sure if more people had listened to that article and paid attention to it, we'd be in a much better situation right now. He's a tech consultant and executive doing work in Silicon Valley, and has led a billion-dollar online education business at Course Hero, where he's a VP of product growth, number of other positions in addition. He has an MBA from Stanford and a couple of Masters of Science degrees in engineering. During the presentation, please, we welcome your interaction. You can use the Q&A function here on Zoom, and I'll read the questions and pass them on to Tomás. We're also going to try and save about 10 or 15 minutes at the end of the seminar for a more general discussion and some questions then. So welcome, Tomás. We're looking forward to your talk about the end of nation states.
Thank you. And so for those who I'm sharing, right? You guys can see this. For those of you who follow me, that you guys are going to see about 50% of content that you might have seen somewhere else, but then 50% that I have never talked about. And because you guys are all illustrious and very intelligent, I'm packed these with a lot of ideas. So I'm going to go quickly. So you just need to keep up. So this is a picture actually of the Bay Area from a plane. And one of the things you can see here is that it's all built in the flat land, but as soon as the mountains start, there's just nothing built, right? And you can see that also here, if you go to Italy, where this is a day and a night, and you can see here that all the lights are on in the valleys. And every moment, every time that you have a mountain, there is nothing, right? Why is that? Because in the flatlands, you have the water doesn't run off. You can have agriculture that's much easier. You can have irrigation that's much easier. Plants are easier to grow. When you have a lot of that, you can have agriculture. If you have agriculture, you can have people. And then on top of this, if you have rivers that are navigable, you can trade that very easily. You can also trade more easily if there's flatlands than if there is mountains. And so you have more people and more wealth in flat areas. And so you have here geography determining a lot of the evolution of a place like Italy or the Bay Area. And then you can zoom out into Europe, for example, and you can realize, okay, actually this is pretty flat at the top. That's the North European plain. And you have all this south here that is very mountainous. And that's due, as you probably know, to the African plate heating into the European plate, Eurasian plate. And that's what's creating all these mountains at the south. And what happens then is that all the water that accumulates from here into the mountains falls very quickly into the Mediterranean because of the mountains, but very slowly in the north. And so that's why you have natural navigable waterways in the north, substantially more than the south, which means that together with the flatlands, you have more agriculture, more people, more wealth than in the south. And so you should remember this next time that you blame Southern Europeans for being lazy. And then just another example, right? Like Hu line in China, 94% of the population is east of that. And that corresponds to the area that is Han here, these brown ones. And there's other ethnicities, but the big one is the Han. And you can see here the percentage, like red means more than 95% are Han. You can see that it's basically all of the east of that Hu line, and very little with the west of it. And it's very connected to the density, right? So a huge density in this area and here in Sichuan and a little bit here more, but nothing west of it. And so why is this? Well, because of that corresponds to the cultivated land. This is the most cultivated and so on and so forth. It corresponds to the line of rain. East of this line, the 15-inch Izoyat, you have much more density of population, and west, you don't have any of it. And the more rain you have, the more population you have. And that's linked to the geography, where here you can actually see in the geography, actually the Hu line is close to this actually. And you can see all of these are flatlands. And these on the west are mountains. And what's happening? Well, you have the winds here in the world that go east to west in towards China at this level of the latitude. And as they hit mountains, the wind goes up, it's colder air, it condensates, it falls. And then when it goes on the other side, there's no more water. And so it's very dry. And so on top of this, now you have here this tectonic plate between India and China, and it's heating. And what's happening is that's what's creating the Himalayas on the south. And then this is the Himalayas and this is Tibet, right? And so what's happening? Well, on top of this, on the east side, you remember there's flat line, there's a flat land. That's the flat land. Here you have China, here you have Korea and Japan. That flat area corresponds to the Pacific plate going under China, and wherever it arrives, it's flat, and wherever it doesn't, it has mountains from the other tectonic plate hit with India. And so you end up having this area that's influenced by the Pacific plate, this area that's influenced by the Indian plate. This is called the north-south gravity lineament line. And what's happening is it's flat east of that, mountainous west of that. So that area gathers all the water. It gathers the flat lands that are perfect for fertility. And then on top of this, then you have all the water caught by the Tibet that flows through two rivers, the Yangtze and Yellow River, into these amazing plain, the North China Plain. And unsurprisingly, this is where China comes from. The Han came from that valley. And so there were so many of them because this was so fertile and so flat and so much agriculture that you had a massive population that expanded little by little through the centuries until it caught the borders of China today. And so I can keep going, but this is why China really is the Han. It's because of tectonic plates, the same reason as Europe is the way it is. And so that's these are some examples of how much geography has driven history in the past. And so if you ask this guy, this is from 1500, hey, how are the next few decades going to be like? He's going to tell you, well, it's going to be the same as the last few centuries, right? This is Europe in the Middle Ages, and you have this feudal system. And on top of this, you have the Catholic Church, which controls most of Western and Central Europe in 1500. And they have been growing in power for hundreds of years. And for all this time, you've had some proto-Protestant movements appearing here and there, challenging the power of the church, but the church destroyed them every time. And so that's why in 1500, it looks like this. And then this is what it looks like 50 years later. Here we're in 1555. The green is the Catholic Church, and the other colors in the north are the Protestant ones. And so how come you have 1,000 years of Catholic church power that suddenly disappears nearly overnight? You know, this is the Reformation. But what's interesting, right? Jan Hus in the 1400 founded the Hussite movement, and he didn't succeed, but whereas Martin Luther did. And so what's the difference? The printing press. With Jan Hus, you needed to write books by hand. It took a full year for a book to be produced. So the best way to propagate your ideas was by talking, which is not scalable. Martin Luther used the printing press very, very heavily. And one of the things that he used it for is the 95 Theses. And the result was the Reformation, thanks to Gutenberg's printing press, which was created just around 70 years before the Reformation started. And so whereas geography used to drive history, technology, like the printing press, has been replacing it. And one way to think about it is in terms of information networks, right? This is a village. You have, in the Middle Ages, you have maybe a nobleman like a knight and maybe the priest, and then a few villagers that talk to each other. And you have a little bit of conversations or of communication with other villages, not too much, but a little bit of trade, a little of interactions. You also have bigger cities with bigger noblemen and bigger higher level priests. And so you have these kind of fractal structure for a population, which gets reflected in the aristocracy. You have knights and barons and earls and dukes and kings, and the same thing for the church, right, with priests and deacons and cardinals and the Pope, except that this one is substantially more connected before the printing press, right? You had all the priesthood that was substantially better educated. They had access to handwritten books that they could share with each other. They had a lingua franca with Latin where all of them could talk with each other. They had correspondence with each other, a European scope. So they really had a monopoly of information and information networks in Europe. Then comes the printing press. And then suddenly ideas can be shared across aristocrats or merchants and across educated citizenry in general. And so that eliminates the monopoly that the church has on the information networks. And so if you ask this guy in 1500, hey, what's going to happen? And then you show him, he's going to be really freaking surprised. Right? Information technology killed the incumbent power because it replaced the existing information networks. And so the question becomes, okay, what's going to replace it, right? What's going to replace the church? As we know, it's nation state, but that also was influenced through the printing press, through a process called print capitalism. And so here, these were the language families in Europe at the time. And languages really were a gradient. So for example, here from Belgium to Lisbon, it's not like you had some French and some Portuguese. No, it was a gradient. Little by little, these languages were different from each other. And so maybe there's a few words that change from a valley to another, but it's very, very gradual. And so what happens with this graduality is as books start being printed, the capital, the cities that were the biggest, were the ones where there were the more writers and also the more readers. And so they attracted the writing in the local vernacular. And so around these big population and culture centers appear little by little over centuries, these languages. And so that's why we have languages that we have today. One, I think, is from this picture is from, I think, the 1400s or so, and this is from the 1600s, right? 2 centuries later, and you can see how dramatic was the concentration of power from this feudal system into these more of a nation, a state kind of system. And so that emergence of these new nation states replacing churches, that would have gotten these guys completely crazy. And that's not the only time that these information technologies have dramatically influenced the political structure, right? What do these guys have in common? Well, you cannot have a totalitarian system without a microphone and a speaker so that you can talk to hundreds of thousands of people in a square, or a radio that enables you to reach millions of people. Without that technology, you just don't have that political system. And so over the centuries, nations, states co-opted books, newspapers, radio, TV, education to strengthen this concept of we're not just a state, we're a nation too. And so we're a nation state. And those media strengthened the position of the nation state. They guided the broadcasters of information on what to tell citizens, and the feedback loop there was very weak. And so that's why they've been able to create this identity of nation states. And so information technology created this new power of nation states. And it's happening again. This new information system, obviously internet, is changing again the political system. And obviously the key one here is now citizens are connected. And so the information flow doesn't go from nation states through broadcasters to citizens, but citizens now are networked. And I'm a good example of this, right? Erik was mentioning the hammer and the dance that was picked up, that was read more than 20 million times and was picked up by more than a dozen countries publicly to guide their strategy. And this is crazy. Like, I'm a random dude. I just had access. I had never done epidemiology until a month before I wrote that article. And so why is this possible? Because I had access to papers through internet, which was impossible before. And I had access to distribution through social networks, which was impossible before. And so you get both the content and the distribution through social networks. And that gave citizens like me an outsized power on influence over governments. QAnon and Satoshi Nakamoto are two other perfect examples of this, right? QAnon, a guy or a small group of guys that has had a dramatic influence in what tens of millions of people believe, and in political representation, Satoshi Nakamoto also has had this outsized impact, creating a $1 trillion asset class, a technology with it, and hundreds of millions of people who believe in cryptocurrencies more than they believe in fiat currencies and nation states. And so you have this power of citizens that comes from the fact that they're so networked, right? QAnon, Satoshi Nakamoto are impossible in a world where we're not connected. You have another big source of undermining the nation state that comes from internet, which is this trend of everything becoming digital, right? Technology is eating, internet is eating the world, technology is eating the world. And every time one of these companies gets created, you have a behemoth that appears. So this is the revenue of travel in the 15 years after 2000. And as that grew as much, number of travel agents went down commensurately, right? And this happens faster and faster and faster because the speed at which technologies get adopted is ever faster. That's what happens every time that one of these companies appears. It becomes a huge behemoth, and where it creates a lot of wealth, but it also replaces a lot of players that were local. And so it concentrates wealth that was globally distributed into a few hands that obviously have a lot of power, not only because they have all the money, but also because they have, some of them, access to information, right? In the case of Facebook, in the case of Twitter, they control information, as Trump learned on January 6th. And not only that, but now you have Elon Musk saying that Starlink is a way to give access to internet anywhere in the world, and really local governments can't really do anything about it. How does transmitting into a country with a local downlink work in the regular other side? They can shake their fist at the sky. So you have these other source of undermining the power of nation states. You have supranational organizations. And this is interesting because it just has happened all the time in history. The question is never whether you can keep all of your sovereignty. History says that you just can't. All along, it has been the fate of humankind to have its fate increasingly shared. Before, you have violence and trade between individuals, and that forms tribes. Violence and trade between tribes forms chiefdoms and kingdoms and empires and leagues. And then we've seen this, right? So more recently, World War I pushed for the League of Nations. World War II pushed for the creation of the UN and the European Union. As there's global financial problems, the IMF and World Bank gain power. Global trade problems gave power to the WTO. Pandemics gave power to the World Health Organization. And I argue that the failure of the World Health Organization is only important insofar as it was so unbelievably necessary. So I don't think the who is going anywhere. I think something like it or itself is going to keep gaining power. So whenever you have a globalized world, you will have globalized governments. And then you have blockchain, right? Bitcoin, Ethereum. And there's the obvious way in which this undermines the power of nation states, because it reduces the power of printing, of the printing press. And so the wiggle room that you have with your fiat currencies, but it goes beyond this, right? Because you have here gatekeepers like financial institutions that are one of the ways that nation states have power over its citizens. But with blockchain, you can have DeFi and you can start taking away the power from these financial institutions. And this is true not just with financial institutions, but really wherever you have a gatekeeper, you can replace that with blockchain and decentralize that governance. So wherever you have an industry that's based in knowledge and not in something more physical, you will have an industry that can replace the gatekeepers of the nation state by something powered by blockchain. And so you have all of these potential, these actors that are reducing the power of nation states at the worst time for them, right? So where Kodak was 150,000 employees, Instagram had just 12 people, it was sold for $1 billion, WhatsApp $22 billion by 55 employees, that's $400 million of value per employee, right? So these employees in tech are generating so much wealth, they're so productive that they obviously are the ones with the biggest jobs that make the most money. And so what happens is as these people keep working on tech, the share of GDP controlled by tech increases, but because they're so productive, actually the share of tech employees does not grow. And so you have here all these 50 jobs, top jobs in the US, and so many of them that are going to be automated. And oh, by the way, of these top 50 jobs, only 3 have been created in the last 60 years, which tells you a lot of about how fast the destruction is going to be of work versus the creation. The creation, because tech is so much more efficient, the creation of jobs is not going to be as fast as the destruction. And so what you happen to have then is a lot of workers that either don't work or are underemployed and which you cannot tax, right? It's this concept of the hollow out, where the medium skilled people, who are the vast majority of people, there's fewer and fewer of them. There's more low skilled people, there's more high skilled people. And obviously that creates the inequality in wealth that we know, with 3.5 billion people in the world that have as much wealth as the top 26. And that is hard because now you cannot tax these middle class, right? You don't have as many workers that you can tax. And so you need to tax these people who are high skilled, except that these high skilled people can move around and they can dodge your taxes. And it's true not only for the creators of these companies, but also for their, right? So this is another example, right? You know this, Lorena Gonzalez from California said this to Elon Musk, and then bam, a few months later, Elon Musk moves to Texas where he pays substantially fewer taxes. And so this mobility of these wealth generators is true for the entrepreneurs. Like here, you have also creators in Spain, for example, they're moving to the equivalent of Puerto Rico in Spain, which is Andorra, where they don't pay taxes. And then the same is going to be true for workers, where a share of all employees working remote during COVID was huge. And here the red is the people who want to work fully remote according to different in tech, according to different, in knowledge-based industries. And so most people actually want either hybrid or remote, and the remote ones can go wherever they want. And so how do you tax the people who can go wherever they want, right? Companies are mobile, the richest companies are mobile, the richest owners are mobile, the richest workers are mobile. And so how do you tax them? It's going to be much harder. And so there's going to be substantially more competition for taxes than there is today, just at a moment where workers, the average worker can be taxed substantially less. Right? It's not a coincidence that of the top 25 countries in GDP per capita, most of them are actually tax havens. And some of them are, have also oil, but if you take out oil, it's mostly tax havens. And that's why Shenzhen, Dubai, Singapore, Hong Kong, all these cities, which were nothing 50 years ago, 100 years ago, now there's these massive metropolises, not a coincidence that they have low taxes. And obviously, we mentioned this, we can print money because of Bitcoin. They printed money in the United States in the just after the Great Recession, and it worked well. And then they tried to do this again, and it doesn't work as well, right? And you have this flight of the money to things that are hedges against it. The stock market is one of them, but obviously Bitcoin is another one of them. And as you have more cryptocurrencies, it's going to be harder and harder to print money without consequences. And so now states have fewer workers to tax. They can't tax them as much, workers and companies and founders, and they can't print money during a demographic ticking bomb, right? So this is Europe, but it's equivalent for the US. Population projection by the UN in Europe is that this year is going to be the top of the population. For now, we're going down. It's due to the number of children per woman, which is vastly under 2.1, which is the replacement rate. By the way, not a single country in the world that has gone down the 2.1 threshold has been able to go back up above it. Not a single one. So that's children per woman. Obviously, life expectancy is going up at the same time, so you don't have children, but you have a lot of older people, which means the ratio of retirees per workers in the European Union, same thing for the US, is going to go from 0.3 to 0.6, right? So for every worker, you have 0.6 retirees in a few decades. And by the way, today, the share of government budget spent on old age benefits, such as, you know, Medicare or Social Security, retirement, that's around 20% in Europe. It's slightly lower in the US, but imagine what happens when you have double the retirees. Are you going to have 40% of the entire budget of the European Union spent on this? That's not the discretionary, that's the entire budget. So nation states, the power goes down with new competing actors, such as individuals, communities, companies, supranational entities. Their income goes down because they have fewer workers to tax. They can't tax those people and companies making money. They can print money. And at the same time, their spend goes up because they have more underemployed people. So they want more redistribution and then more retirees. So nation states are not in a good position, and they are in a very similar position to what the church was 500 years ago. They were the incumbent power, and you had these information network technology, which was the book at the time, that replaced it with these new nation states. And now we have these nation states that are completely crumbling in power, and the question becomes, what will replace nation states? And so for that, we need to understand actually this concept, right, of nation states, where the key component, the nation, right, means that my identity is loosely linked to this geography. Like in this place, there's a bunch of people and we all share this identity, which we call the nation. And that is the logic for binding us together, right? So this identity comes from these information networks, right? The way we're sharing information, the way we're sharing our culture, through information networks, and that's what creates this nation, and it was linked to geography. States means that the governance is linked to the geography, which is linked to the fact that assets are linked to geography. What does that mean? We have the original source of states is the monopoly of violence, right? You have trade in an area, there might be crime, there might be violence. And so you grow to control that area so that you have a monopoly of violence so that trade can happen seamlessly. And that creates value and that enriches the state. But here what's happening is that these information networks are becoming digital and the assets are also becoming digital. So where the nation and the state were anchored to geography, now both of them become anchored to the digital world. And so the question, there's two questions, right? On the nation side, what identities will emerge? Are there going to be identities that are stronger than the nation that undermine the nation the same way as the nation undermine the identity of religion? And the second one is, what state services are geographically bound? Because those are geographically bound are going to remain the ownership of the geographic state. But the state services that are not bound to geography, why would they remain in the scope of a geography state? Right? So let's start with what identities will emerge. Now, for starters, English is by far the number one language in terms of GDP. And globally, that bleeds enormously in languages, in internet. More than 50% of all websites are in English. The result is that most popular languages being learned around the world, the English is about 20 times the second one, which is French, and is more than all the other ones combined. Why? Because of network effects, right? If most of the revenue, if most of the people are learning already English, you want to join that network, not another network. And so by far now, English is the most valuable language to learn. That's why everybody's learning it. And so in one or two generations, suddenly everybody will learn English, will know English. And remember what happened last time, right? When books evolved and grew, they created the nation around the scope of the language of the book. So now, if you have suddenly a language that's global, what happens is that the geographically bound identities are going to slowly melt away to start creating a global identity. And so that's one of the reasons why the somewheres are going to be replaced by the anywheres, right? The somewheres, people who are rooted into a geography, anywheres, people who feel comfortable anywhere in the world. And so there's more identities that can be created through digital, right? It's not just this uniformization. You also have now suddenly these vertical communities, these people who were too far away from each other before to form a community. Now they can form a community through internet. Left and right is an obvious one. One better way to think about left and right is actually urban versus rural. That's the biggest predictor of the, Democrat versus Republican. And so you can think in terms of, oh, okay, now you have, you had to be bound together, but not anymore. And you have these information networks now that are creating these identities that are more urban versus rural. Black Lives Matters was a movement that started in the US, but you've had support from these ideas everywhere in the world, even in places that didn't have a lot recent history of slavery. Climate change activists can be understood as a group of people who care more about the world, the environment of the world, than they care about the nation. Crypto is a community, 200 million people strong. They have a very defined set of beliefs. They have a set way of thinking how problems should be resolved. And so you can consider them as one of these communities, rationalists, transhumanists. All of these are what we could consider proto-virtual nations, right? These communities that are based on digital, but they have a culture that's shared, not just a culture, but also a strong opinion on how we should be governed. Right? And that happened in the past. You had past virtual nations, like churches were virtual nations, really. And communism was also a kind of virtual nation, right? Where they say, workers of the world unite. What they're saying is the nation is not the right way to think about it. It's the social class. And so the Soviet Union really had to be geographically bound because the information networks didn't exist. But you could understand it as a virtual community that had a geographic instantiation. So that's for identities. You can see these proto-nations emerging. And then the other question is the state. What state services are geobound? So this is a breakdown of most of the biggest services that the state provides in a country like the US. And if you look at it, there's actually few that are bound to geography. Violence, especially military, it's defined as defending your borders. Parks, dams, public works, police, weather, fire protection, these things are geobound, but the other stuff is actually not geobound, like inequality. Why does it make sense that a Californian is taxed to fund the retirement of an Oklahoman instead of funding the unemployment or the retirement of a European with whom they might share the exact same ideas? Because let's imagine both of them are transhumanists and they want to have that solidarity between them, right? Education, why does it need to be geobound? Regulation, like food, medicines, why does it need to be geobound? Endowment protection, why does it need to be geobound? Like when Notre Dame burned in Paris, you had all these American donors that gave a lot of money. It makes no sense that this is geobound. And so you can imagine an unbundling of nation states where you have a bunch of services that remain bound to a geographic state. And a lot of these services of states that can be delivered by digital states. And so digital communities can take over state services that are not geographically bound. And so what will happen in the future? Nation states lose power to corporations, individuals, communities, supranational organizations. They lose money and influence. English erases intellectual borders. The identity of global communities strengthens online. Communities develop network governance mechanisms. Some increase their share of digital governance services. Some instantiate geographically. Some existing nation states shed the nation and adopt communities. And you can think of, for example, El Salvador today with crypto or Dubai with finance as two examples of these states or nation states that move more towards communities than towards nation states. And challenger community-based states grow versus nation states. The national sentiment becomes a secondary and nation states are replaced by community states over the decades and centuries. And so the only question that remains from this is how will community states organize themselves? And that, I think, is the core question that we need to solve in the next decade or two. How global communities can organize themselves to take on more and more services in digital states. So we'll talk about that another time. Great. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Tomás. That was amazing. I covered, like you said, as you promised, you covered a lot of territory there. And we have a lot of questions as well. But let me highlight a few of them for you here. Let me start with one from Andrew von Nordenflicht. He says that digital technologies that undermine various aspects of nation states are in turn underpinned by a physical infrastructure, like electricity production, transmission, communication infrastructure, wires, satellites, et cetera. And some entity or entities need to provide and control them. So won't that be a source of power for the government? There's still a physical infrastructure to these.
Yeah. So a couple of thoughts about it, right? So there's one thing that I haven't commented on is the fact that there's a bifurcation that can be happening. In fact, all of these that I'm saying presupposes that the government is not going to stop all of this, right? There is a way to stop it, and China is walking that path. You can actually control all of the digital networks. But then what happens is a lot of the value from these information networks disappears. The key of the value that's created is the fact that every person can talk with each other. You eliminate that, you eliminate a lot of the value. And so there's going to be a massive economic penalty. In the case of countries like North Korea or China, they might not care because they care more about the power. But this is a bifurcation.
That's pretty big. I mean, maybe they're making a bet that with 1.3 billion people, that's big enough. I mean, they have a pretty thriving tech sector within that.
Yeah. So this is I'm going to try to address it in 2 minutes. The frontier in GDP per capita is the United States, no big country in the world gets at the same level of GDP per capita as the United States. Every other country is at one level or the other. In the case of Australia, for example, they get close at 90%, 95%. Canada, same thing. And then you go down from there. Like France is, I think, 80%. UK is 70%. And so what happens, for example, we talk about the miracle after World War II. There was no miracle. It's just Europe was catching up with the United States in GDP per capita. And so the miracle that's China today is just China catching up with GDP per capita. Now, the level at which they stop that growth is going to be determined mostly by their governance, right? And so today, they actually slow down in their GDP per capita in the next 6 years or so growth. And there's two reasons for that. Their demographic growth is down, and actually demographic growth has an impact on GDP per capita. But then also they might be in the middle income trap, which is linked to governance. And so it's fine to be extremely totalitarian when you're growing at 10% a year and everybody's like, okay, who cares? I'm rich. But when you're growing at 3% or even less, it's going to be substantially more problematic. And so I think the Chinese problem is it's going to get much worse in a few years. And they're going to really suffer from these loss of productivity due to their governance. And so it's going to be much, much, much harder for them to maintain this without social unrest, which means that they're going to be even more totalitarian so that they don't lose their heads. But so now going back to the question, right? Mm-hmm. This is this big bifurcation. And so I think that countries like Europe and the US, they won't be able to go in this direction. It's going to be too hard for them. And so they will need to leave internet open. That is also an optimal in terms of the economy. And so it's kind of hard to fight this. And as I mentioned before, with SpaceX, actually, you don't need actually the infrastructure. You can have your own antenna to receive it, and you don't need anybody else. And so you can have access to the network without the government approval.
Well, let me push on that a little harder. I mean, yeah. Aren't there some infrastructure that are very geographically bound? I mean, are you saying that
there's a lot.
Political parties or transhumanists or whoever else wouldn't need to access a physical infrastructure? Or if they do need to access a physical infrastructure, which seems more plausible, doesn't that whoever controls that have a lot of power?
Well, the way I would think about this is like the church. Like, did the church need access to physical infrastructure? You know, kind of like that. I think that's the interesting piece, where you had the secular power and the virtual power on top of it, and they interacted each other. And so, and it was so much so at the end of the feudal system that the church overpowered the secular system. And I think that's a more reasonable thing. I think there will be instances of nation states that are community states, like there were papal states in Italy. But I don't think these are going to be the majority, or that they're going to be the first. I think first, what happens is you have these communities that become substantially stronger, and they are strong enough that they can influence policy. Just a recent example, right? The U.S. government, like the Senate and the House, trying to pass legislation against crypto, and then the crypto community being strong enough to push back against it. So this is actually a very nascent example of how these communities can start having power on geographically bound nation states.
Yeah, tell us a little bit more about specifically the role of crypto in enabling this and the blockchain. Do you see the current version of it with proof of work being the way it's going to play out, or is it?
Yeah. So I think there's two things that need to be dramatically separated, and they're bundled together in cryptos today. They shouldn't. One of them is the technology, and the second one is the culture. There's this adage, right, that not a single use case for crypto, for blockchain really requires blockchain. And I think I actually would put aside Bitcoin, because I do think, like, very fundamentally it needs the blockchain. But if you go into the detail of a lot of projects, mm-hmm. there's usually some failures where the blockchain is actually not ideal. Like, for example, you have these games, I don't know, Axie, right? You have Axie, it's a game that has its own currency. And you can buy NFTs, you can buy the currency. that is only valid insofar as these digital goods and this cryptocurrency feeds into the game. You eliminate the game, and that is worthless. And where is this game run? Is it in a public database? No, it's in a private database. And so really the only value of Axie is in connection to the company that runs the servers. And so there's a failure point. And so if you look at all of these projects, like most of them, not all of them, most of them have a point of failure in the technological side where really you need some kind of this centralization, and decentralization is not useful. Today, this might happen in the future. But the point for me is there's a question around tech and we can debate this. Mm-hmm. There's another one that I don't think can be debated, and that's the interesting one, which is the cultural side, mm-hmm. right? You might need centralized technology for some of these things, but the point is there's no turning back in having this decentralized concept. There's no turning back in tokenization of the economy. There's no turning back in DAOs. There's no turning back in putting in code all these rules to organize in ourselves. And I think that's where the power lies, where before we accepted gatekeepers, and now we just don't accept them anymore. That's where the power of crypto lies.
Okay. Well, that leads me to a question from Quentin Hardy, who used to teach a course on some of this stuff, I guess, back at, about 10 years ago. And he says that people will die for their country and even for other things like the religion. But will they die for some of these other virtual communities? And if they won't die for them, is that really the core thing that they live for? So that really is kind of a cultural question.
Yeah. So this is the good thing. This is the amazing thing about the example of the church versus nation state. It's like we know what happened, and we can just look. Okay, what happened before is going to be the same thing. And they say like the same thing happened like 500 years ago. People died for the religion, and they didn't die for the nation. Like for starters, because it didn't exist, right? So if you think about it, out of the 196 countries existing today, only about 50 existed at the end of World War II. Only 50. Right? Of the 196 countries that exist today, in 1800, in the year 1800, only 12 were nation states mm-hmm. that qualify fully as nation states. France was one. The UK or maybe England rather, the Netherlands was one, Japan was one, there's a few, there's like a dozen. And so all of it to say, the concept of the nation state is completely artificial, it has been created, it didn't exist before, and the same way as that identity has been manufactured by states, you can manufacture that identity. And so today, I would argue that these anywheres, they don't feel these allegiance to the nation state. And the more everybody speaks English, the more these digital communities become stronger and stronger, the less you're going to feel for the nation and the less you're going to be willing to die for it.
And do you see people having a primary allegiance to one of these groups, or are they going to be kind of members of multiple, dozens of groups simultaneously? How do you see that playing out?
That's an interesting one, right? Because before the by definition you had the default that's the monopoly of the geography, right? But
there are a few people, maybe a tiny fraction of people who kind of had multiple passports and considered.
That's right. But then, like even today, like what's it's not like people are like, oh yeah, I'm American. No, like, I'm American. I'm also Californian. I am also from San Francisco. I am also a tech worker. I think identity is already many things. Mm-hmm. It just happens that the nation state was overpowering them all because it had the monopoly of violence and all that stuff. And so I think we are evolving more, we're going in the direction where identities are much more fluid. And I think I was just thinking about this a few days ago. Who will we want to get our digital governance services from, right? And I thought about it a little bit like the companies today, our private goods. It's not like it's one company, like depending on the service that you need, you might go for one or the other. And so you could imagine, oh, I like the regulation of these organizations for my my drugs, right? So today, as you know, the US doesn't regulate chemical compounds, in food. There's very few regulated by the US. The European Union regulates dramatically more. What if you are American? You say, actually, I want the European version. And so you can have a label that says, you know, it's European, but it doesn't need to be your European Union label. It can be a community that organizes to do the labels for food. And so you can have each one of these identities where you have these communities that emerge on one area of focus, and they do this well, and they deliver the services for that particular area.
So let's come to that key question you brought up about the monopoly on violence. And you know, people are still physical, as one of the commenters has pointed out. So in China, when you know they had a lot of Bitcoin miners for a while, and then the government has guns and could go in and say, okay, you're not going to be doing that anymore, and shut them down. And when push came to shove, one group had the power and the other group didn't. You gave the example in the US where there was a push against some types of crypto, and then the crypto argument won. So is the story that even if the government has the geographic government has a monopoly on violence, it can be co-opted or influenced, yeah, or even controlled by these other entities, or how does that who ends up having the ultimate monopoly on violence?
Yeah. Or is there? So I think we're also bundling violences here because the nation state has a monopoly on all types of them, but there's two very, very different types of violence. You have state sponsored violence and non-state sponsored violence, which means basically the military and the police, and these are radically different. So the military is there to protect the physical assets, like the physical integrity of your country. And as more of these assets move from geographic to digital, there is less of a value for that geographical defense. There's still going to be one, mm-hmm, but it's much less valuable. And in fact, digital assets have this interesting thing where if another country attacks you to take over those digital assets, what does it mean? Like, what does it mean? Oh, it's like is China going to
or agriculture or minerals?
Exactly. Is China going to invade the U.S. to have Google? No, you can't. Right. So on the state-sponsored violence, I think it's going down dramatically, but it remains. You still
what
have.
What about cyber? There is still cyber attacks, right?
So yes, you can have cyber attacks, but I don't think cyber attacks, state-sponsored cyber attacks, are not to destroy, unless you're in a geographic-bound war, you don't want to destroy the assets of the other country, because actually, because of trade, you have a huge benefit in having those assets, like, right? So that's on the state-sponsored side. But the crime is a different animal, right? Before, crime was linked to geography because assets were geographic. But if you have the assets digitally, then you have, this is a different animal. And like 2 weeks ago, there was a founder of a social network in Spain that was attacked in his home and tortured for a few hours until he gave away the keys to his Bitcoin. And it's in the millions of euros. And so that's an example of what happens. Like the sovereign individual talked about this. I believe either this is going to happen and it's going to happen more, or there's just going to be a technical solution to this. Like so Coinbase, for example, you have the you can freeze, you get store, you have cold storage for your assets. You can also have two different emails to confirm a transaction, and so you can have ways in which it's substantially harder to force you physically to get your digital assets. And so I think actually the overall violence is going to go down. That's a hope, though.
Well, we have a few minutes left here, but I wanted to ask you a little bit more about the technology that you see underpinning this transformation. I didn't quite, I'm not sure I totally got what you were saying about the role of the blockchain and those technologies. At one point, you said that most of them could be done other ways, that the blockchain was not essential. But but I think I didn't quite understand that correctly. But
yeah, and I'll give you an example, and I think it goes at the core of the question that matters the most, which is how will digital communities govern themselves? Mm-hmm. And I like using an example, which is the encyclopedias, right? So you had the Encyclopedia Britannica, and what was Encyclopedia Britannica? It was a bit more than 100 people in a room together thinking, analyzing, making some calls, looking at data. And then every now and then, they put all their things on paper and they push it out. And that's an encyclopedia. Those were very intelligent people, probably more intelligent than the average person. But then comes Wikipedia and completely destroys them. And nobody saw it coming because they say, oh, like it's impossible that aggregating the knowledge of a few million people is going to go anywhere. But here's the key thing about Wikipedia. It was a mechanism for crowdsourcing information so that whatever area you were an expert on could bubble up. And then there was a mechanism to reconcile all of these insights in a way that you end up being faster. You end up being more accurate and have substantially more quantity of information. Now, the exact same thing is going to happen to governance. Today, lawmakers are like the Encyclopedia Britannica 25 years ago. Mm-hmm. It's a bunch of people in a room thinking and talking with each other and analyzing and making some calls. And then every now and then, they publish some papers, and that's our governance, that's our laws. And so obviously, the same way as Wikipedia replaced Encyclopedia Britannica, there is going to be a mechanism that is going to replace legislation, the lawmaking process. It just needs to be one that properly aggregates the knowledge and the effort of different people. And I haven't solved this, but this is probably the thing that occupies most of my brain. And I think there's a few directions in which this is going, where you can build these mechanisms for better governance.
So it would be kind of like a crowdsourced set of laws and constitutions.
And you also already have some examples, right? So if I ask you, who's the president of Switzerland, you're going to blank. And if I ask you actually one president of all of its history, you're going to blank. And that's because it doesn't. And it's a substantially more networked government with everybody being asked their opinion about everything. I don't think that is the way to go. But I think it shows that this is actually doable. And so there's many ways in which democracy fails today, right? Like, for example, the bandwidth of information that goes from the citizenry to lawmakers is too low. It's like a few surveys and one vote every 4 years. It's just like the bandwidth is too low. Right. Another one, which is because of these, you need to bundle a lot of solutions, right? You're voting for a party with all these solutions, and you shouldn't. Another thing is you're bundling the solutions to the goals, right? And in fact, you shouldn't. Like, you should say, hey, this is what I'm optimizing for, but the mechanisms to achieve this should be separated from your opinions, because you're not an expert on what works and what doesn't. You are an expert, though, on what matters to you. And so these are some examples of where I think this is going.
Yeah, well, I mean, there is an argument that it's not just because of lack of bandwidth that we have representatives make the decisions. It's also, you know, most people have the time and energy to know all the nuances. I mean, here in California, we have like a lot of propositions in every vote. And I tried pretty hard to study them all, but with dozens and dozens of different propositions, I don't feel qualified to make some of those decisions. So
exactly.
I want
to. That makes no sense. And so you shouldn't be able to do this. What you should be able to do to say is, look, I care about these things, right? Not the propositions. Like the number one thing that matters to me is economic development, right? Healthcare, blah, blah, blah. So you can have these things, and then you have a mechanism where you don't need to participate in all these decisions. You can participate in the ones that you know about. Well, it turns out that you know a lot about automation and work. And so this piece of legislation, I know for a fact that this is wrong. And so you need a mechanism so that Erik can propose something, but because it's right, it wins.
Well, I like the Wikipedia model, because that is kind of how it works, that you know, there are thousands or maybe hundreds of thousands of articles there, and I've contributed to a couple of them, but most of them I wouldn't be very helpful to contribute to. So that's great. Well, this is absolutely fascinating. So much information, and I'm sorry we're out of time. You do have a blog post on this at your website on Uncharted Territories, so I I refer people to that. It's got lots more links and facts about it. And
And in fact, I haven't talked about many of these. So the end of nation states, I've talked about the origin of nation states, the church and all that stuff. I haven't talked about the unbundling of the nation states, the communities that are emerging, the future of violence. And so those are things that I'm working on, but I haven't published yet. So Uncharted Territories, you have to sign up if you want to receive those.
Yeah, no, great talk and great agenda that you're doing. So thank you so much for sharing that all with us. I'm afraid we are out of time, and so we're going to have to move on. And in fact, that ends our seminar series for the fall quarter here at Stanford. We'll be restarting next year, so stay tuned. We'll be posting the new set of speakers shortly, but that's it for this year. Thanks, everyone, for joining us, and thanks so much, Tomás, for sharing your insights with us. It was great talking to you.
It was a true pleasure. Thank you so much for your time, and I look forward to doing more of these in the future.
Great.
All right, cheers.
Okay. Bye, folks.